Here we go. We are in Parashat Shmot. Okay. The first pasuk says, and it's a strange thing. You normally, we learn in every grammar course in history, you don't start a sentence with and. And it says, Ve'ele Shmot B'nei Yisrael, and these are the names of B'nei Yisrael, Haba'im, Mitzrayim, that are coming to Mitzrayim. And that's also strange. That uses the present tense that is coming. Okay. Et Yaakov, with Yaakov. Ishu Beito, a man and his household, Ba'u, they came. So Rashi says, what's going on here? He says, he doesn't go on the Vav so much, but it's more, Alpha Pishamanam Bechayehen Bishmotan, even though that they were all counted during their lifetimes with their names, Chazum and Amitatan. We go back and we recount them even in the deaths. Lo Diyechi Batam Shem Shul Kochavim, to inform us of their. How dear they are that they're compared to the stars. Shemotzim achnisim b'mispar v'shemotam, that they are brought out and they brought back in by the multitudes and their names. Okay, so that's Rashi's take on that. The Dodd Zakenim says ve'elu halokavar ba'u. It says they already came. What does it mean habaim? The ones who are coming. It does make sense. The ones who are coming. This is the book in Genesis finished that they came and that they took hold of the land. So what does it mean that they are coming now? Again, they're using a present tense. God is using a present tense here. So why is God using present tense? So he says, "Well, galoka var ba'u, they already came before lachain elakodem shemait Yosef." But rather what we're learning is before Yosef died, lo natan alehem misim. They were not being taxed. Okay? Mishamate, once he died, not natan alehem venasa ki'ilu bo v'yom ba'u. They did put taxes upon them, and it was as if they had just come that day. In other words, you just came in, we're going to charge you a visitor tax. Fine? Even though it's many years later.
This is, if we were to literally translate, it says, B'nai Yisrael Haboim, they, the children of Israel,
right,
are coming.
Right.
Is it correct?
The ones who are coming.
Yeah. So
the ones who are coming.
Okay, so they
just grab a chumash.
They somehow translated here who were coming.
Because he wants to.
What are they telling us in English here?
That what they're doing is making the language work better. That's all they're doing. But I always say that whenever you make a translation, you're already making a payer. You're already making an explanation on the text. And you're taking away all the problems of the text. So that when people are listening or reading it, they say there's no problem. So what the rabbis bothered with? But really that is the problem. That is Habba'im, the ones who are coming. And the reason they say that is because it's as if now that Joseph is dead, so now they're treating B'nai Israel as if they just came today, and now they're charging a tax. Okay, that's what we're learning there. There's a lot of other stuff to learn, but that's basically what's going on. In verse 2, on page 292. Then it says, who are the children? Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehuda, Yisachar, Zevulun, Vinyamin, Davin, Naphtali, Gad, Asher. You have all 12 kids. So we'll find out why we have to go through all those names. And then it says, Vayihi kol nefesh yosei yerechei akov shivim nefesh. It was all the souls. By the way, it was, I said all the souls, but it's really every soul that came out from the thigh of Yaakov, shivim nefesh. So that's 70 soul. By the way, it's not shivim nefeshot, because it's anything above 10, just grammatically, anything above 10 will always be in the singular. So that's not a question. But the rabbis make a question of this, because they say when it was talking about Esav kids, it said nefashot. Well, it should say nefashot. It's only sheish. It's below 10. But it's, and so they want to say there that in Esav, that there was different concepts going on. With us, we were unified. It's a nice drasha, but it's not because of the grammar. And the grammar works that way. And then it was Yosef Hayav Mitzrayim. Yosef was in Mitzrayim. So that's, we go through all those names. Now, why do we have to go through all those names? Why do we have to recount again? So there is a commentary, I just can't remember where I saw it, that said, oh, it's a Balatorum, that says that we count by the names of Bnei Yisrael because they didn't change their names. And we're being told that again. That the Jews, one of the four things that they were, that gave them merit was that they did not change their names. They used Hebrew names. They never gave in to the other names. Now, this is also, Arsko brings this down. I forget who they call it. He says it in, I think it was Arsko. Where was it? Well, you'll see it in Arsko somewhere where he says that Yosef was saying to his brothers, even though I'm called Sanaf Paneach by the people, don't allow them to change your names. You keep your names. So what happens is the original brothers keep their name. And while they're there, while they are alive, people follow that. But once they die, so now the children are no longer remaining on that spiritual level. While they may not have changed their names, they start to sink lower and lower and lower into the abyss of Mitzrayim. Okay, that's what they're getting from that. So let's continue. And it says, Vayamat Yosef v'cholechav. So we're on six. Vav. Vayamat Yosef v'cholechav. Now Yosef and all his brothers died. V'chol hador ahu. And all of that generation. Okay, so that's, and then what happens? V'nei Yisrael paru v'yishesu v'yir v'yashmu ma'od. V'nei Yisrael was fruitful. And they swarmed and they increased greatly and they grew very strong. Ma'od, ma'od. But Tamilah Aretz Otam. And the land was filled with them. Now, from here, if you count Paru, Paru 1, Vishutsu 2, Vayirbu 3, Vayismu 4, the Ma'od 5, Ma'od 6. That's how we know that they had 6 children every time after, in the pregnancy. Now, which tribe did was not included in this miracle? Does anybody know? What? Levi. Levi. Why? Why was Levi not included in this miracle? Because they weren't subjugated by the Egyptians. They weren't doing the hard work. They were the priestly class. They were the teaching class. So they weren't part of that. And I think it's the Ramban who says that every people had a priestly class, the ones who would teach. And they were not affected by that. And everybody, it was just understood that everybody has to have that teaching, that class of people. And Levi fit the bill for that. Now, one other thing was that when it said that Yosef was in Mitzrayim, I'm just going back to 5, Rashi says, V'alo hu banav, hu banav hayu b'chlal shivan. Certainly, he and his sons were part of the 70. What is it coming to exclude? What are we telling? Why are you telling me that Yosef was in Mitzrayim? So it's to tell us the righteousness of Yosef, that Yosef was the shepherd of his father's sheep, and also he was the one in Mitzrayim who was made a king, but he stayed in his righteousness. That's why we have to hear that. Okay, now we go to the next one. Now here's the big thing. Vayakam Melchadash. Al Mitzrayim, we're on Chet 8. And the king of, a new king arose over Mitzrayim, over Egypt. Asher lo yadat Yosef, that did not know Yosef. Okay, so what does that mean? First of all, there's a major problem. What is it, who is it, a new king? Rashi says, Rav and Shmuel, there's an argument between the two rabbis, Rav and Shmuel. Chad Amar Chadash Mamash. One opinion says that it was really a new king, just a brand new king. And the other one says, no, it was not a new king. It was one who just renewed his gezeres, his decrees. That's all. And why does he say that? Because it doesn't say, Vayamat Vayimloch. Right? It, It doesn't say, I'm sorry, it doesn't say Vayakam Vayimloch. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that he was reigning over. If you normally, if you go to some other places, like in Bereshis, if you go back to Bereshis in, I think it was Parsha Vayeshev, I'm not sure, no, Vayigash, Vayeshev, something like that, we're talking about the different kings that in the place of, let me just see really quickly. That wasn't here. So what we're talking about, Esav's children growing. And it gives you eight kings. Remember that where it gave you eight? I think it was eight kings. And it just said, he was king, he died, and another king arose. Right? So in that case, Vayama Vayimloch. Right? That's what it was. He died, and another king came up. Here it just says, Vayakam El Chadash. So if it's Vayakam El Chadash, so it means that, one, it's a lot of theories you could go with, but it just could mean that there was no new king in reality. He just renewed his decrees. So if that's the case, what does it mean he didn't know? Following Rashi, Asa Atzmo Ki'ilu Lo Yada. He made himself like he didn't know. He acted like I don't know who he is. That's number one. So now...
Yeah, well, was this king was not alive when Yosef was here, yeah?
If it would have been a new king, then you're right. But if it's the old king...
How old would he be?
People lived... God only knows, for a long, long time. Sometimes they had the merit to live. Yosef died young. Who knows how old Yosef, who knows how old Pharaoh was when Yosef took over? That's another thing. He could have been a child king. We don't know how old Yosef was. I mean, we don't know how old the king was. But anyway, so the Kli Yakar, first the Ibn Ezra. He says, Ve'yakar Melech Hadash. Perusho, the explanation is like it's implied. Pelotosevich, Lohaya, Mizera, Mlucha. And this guy is a new king, but he wasn't from the seed of the kings. He was not a royal person originally. Okay? Al-Kain, that's why it says, Vayakam, he arose. Kamo ki hekim b'nei alavdi, that you put my children as slaves, but you made them like that. So it could be that this guy was not of royalty originally, which means that the other, the Egyptian king, who had originally brought in Yosef, who had the dream and appointed Yosef, could have been displaced. And now this guy comes up. That's a possibility. The Dazikanim, he says like this. Who... Paro Rishon, he was the first Paro. And so Amrulo, they said to him, the people said to him, Bob and his Davig al Uma, come, let's engage on this nation. Amalehem, Adata Anuchayam Mishalehen. He said to them, until now we've been living because of them. Hechnus Daveglem, so how can we go against them? Velosham Alehem, but, and he didn't listen to them. Horeduhu Mikiso, they pulled a rebellion, they pulled a coup, and they pulled him down from his chair. In other words, you're no longer our king. Shloshechadashim, so they, for 3 months. Kev and Shirah, once he saw this, Kachamar lehem, Esh malachem, he said, I will listen to you. Lechein, lechach katav, Vayakam, arose. He arose. So it's the same guy. What happened was he had a rebellion on his hands. He, and that's every good politician. Okay, they have a rebellion on their hands, so he can't fight everybody. People want something from him. He says no, and then they kick him out of office. He doesn't like being out of office, so he says, okay, I give. So then, okay, Vayakam, we'll raise you up again as a new pharaoh. Yeah, so now you can still like a new pharaoh, yeah. You have to speak up.
Sorry. Pharaoh that
Moshe
talks to is the same Pharaoh that Yosef talks to.
That's what we want to say. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Again, some people live a long, right. Long time. Yeah. It could be that. It could be a different one. God only knows. But it's and truly, God only knows.
Yeah.
But some people want is some the Ramban would say many times that Pharaoh was just the name. of the leader, just like you have Avimelech. Otherwise, Avimelech lives a very long time. Og lives a very, extremely long time. And so it could have been that everybody who was called out, everybody who took that position was called Pharaoh, just like in this country, everybody who becomes a president is called the president, Mr. President. Huh. I mean, we are very, because of our culture these days, we're very first name people here. So we say Barack, or we disrespectfully Obama. Okay, we don't say President Barack or President Obama. We don't say that. So we're very, what's it called? When I'm very, I wouldn't call you by Mr. Ornstein, I call you Mark. Familiar. We're very familiar with people. Yeah, yeah. People don't like they don't like to be called Mr. anymore.
They do that in Israel, long before here, yeah?
Yeah, Israel was from socialism. So it makes sense that they would do that. Yeah. But I'm saying, Golda, you wouldn't say Prime Minister Meir. Who Bibi? Said it? Bibi, even Netanyahu. So all those things, yeah, we're very familiar with people, and it's
like,
sorry?
Not everybody here. Maybe it depends on the culture, but not everybody here.
Most of Americans are now. You would say most? Which country, which people are looking at?
Conservative, Bible Belt, those old Baptists.
Okay, so fine. If you would want to argue that, right, I'm not sure conservative aren't so familiar.
There still are some.
Say it again?
If there are still conservatives in the country.
Okay, but I'm not sure. What I'm saying is I'm not sure that even if I'm a conservative, that I wouldn't be using first names with people. I'm not sure.
I think it's more than that. It's that,
It's funny watching the debates on both Republican and Democrats on TV. It's always first. I mean, they're calling each other first. The moderator doesn't say that, but they're all, would think that in,
right,
on a public stage like that, they would show far more respect.
And
to each other
originally they did.
Yeah.
Originally there was a respect. See, that's what I'm saying. Familiarity breeds contempt.
Yeah.
And it's not nice anymore where we have people calling. Again, when I'm with my colleagues, it was very funny. When I go to the RCA, the Rabbinical Council of America, so everybody there is a rabbi, okay? And my father brought me up to call a rabbi, rabbi. Fine. So I was saying to the one who was running the event, I said, oh, rabbi, Shalom Aleichem, nice to see you. He said, here we go by first names because we're all rabbis. So no problem, rabbi. Okay. I said, my father wins on this one. You know, sometimes I'll give in if they're my age, if they're my colleagues, if not, they're my peers. So then why would I call them rabbi? Unless they are in public. Mm. If they are in public, I will always, I don't care what they are, Reformed, Conservative, Reconstructionist, Open Orthodox, doesn't matter to me. I did that for the tape. Okay. But I will always call, and I think everybody knows that, I will call them rabbi and I'll introduce them as rabbi and I will not show disrespect because it's not for me. What are you doing? It is a doctor. You call them doctor if they're a doctor. When I go to my doctor's appointment, even though he'll call me by my first name, I think he calls me by my first name. He may call me Mr. Neville these days. I don't know. But a rabbi, whatever. It could be. But I always just say doc. You know, I don't get into the whole thing. I could call him by his first name. He wouldn't be upset because we're all exactly the same age. It would make sense. But again, it's that you call it conservatism. Fine. That's how I was brought up.
Yeah. I think that's like
traditional.
Traditional.
Yeah.
Right.
A good friend of mine here, Chief Stone. You know, the kids call him Chief Stone. He is not Kurt.
Uh-huh.
Kurt to me. He's Chief Stone.
The police officer.
Navy.
Navy. Okay. I thought you were saying an Indian chief. No, but that, I'm right. But that's what it is. We won't allow our kids to call anybody by the first name.
We
said uncle and aunt or Mr. Whatever you want to do. You pick a name.
Yeah. We had house staff. They called us, like, I was Mr. Charles.
Uh-huh. Right. So I'm saying that's what was missing, that they had familiarity. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really what was going on. So now, that's how the Dazakanim said it. And they said, Asher lo yadat Yosef, he didn't know Yosef. So Amar Rav Yehuda ben Levi, he gives you a mashal. He gives you a parable. He says, to one who was throwing stones at a statue of the king. So what they do, they took him, and then they freed him the next day. They took the guy who was throwing stones at the statue of the king. So they arrested him, boom, in jail, you're into jail. Then the next day, they released him. What happens? Now he stones the king himself.
Oh.
You released me, I'm gonna stone the king. So also Pharaoh. In the beginning, it was that he didn't know Yosef. That's what it says. In the end, he says, I don't know Hashem. I don't know Hashem. Who is this God that you're talking about? So why? What's the comparison? They're making Yosef the statue, if you will, of God. Because it says that Yosef's... Oh, I want to make sure I'm right. I think it's Yosef's face was engraved, it's either Yosef or Yaakov, I'm not sure which one anymore. It was engraved on the chariot of that chair that Ezekiel sees. It was one of the, it must have been Yaakov, I take that back. It was Yaakov. Okay. But that's what is going on there. Okay. So now,
Does the chair still exist?
No, it's a heavenly chair.
Oh,
okay. So yes, it still exists, but you have to go into Ezekiel.
Oh, I thought you were talking about like a...
No, it's not a real chair. Okay, so that's what's going. That's who this king is. Doesn't know. He's claiming he doesn't know. Okay, and like I said, the the main thing is either, however you're going to take it, either he acts like he doesn't know, or it was a new king he didn't know. Could have been a new king. It's possible. So what happens? Ve'yomer elamo. He says to his nation, "Hine am ben Israel. Behold, the nation of the children of Israel." Rav Atzimimena, they're very melted and they're greater than us. What's he getting involved now? This is very interesting. Pharaoh was a monarch. A monarch does not need to talk to his cabinet. We want to go to war. President Obama must convince the... he has to convince them to pay, I should say. He can send the troops to war, but he has to convince them to continue paying for the war. Whoever it is, okay? Whoever the president is. The president has limited power. He can only do certain things. And then after that's done. Fine. And if you... Don't ask on the president, okay? I'm not really interested. I'm only using that as an example. Okay? So now what happens is you have this guy who's a monarch. Could order people to death. And what's he saying to his people? We need to have a discussion here. This nation, they're very strong, and they're stronger than us. Hava nechakmolol, let's be smart with them, with him, with it. Penirbe, lest they increase more, lest they increase. Vaya, and then it will be. Ki tikrenel milchama, when we go to war, when war is happening, v'nosaf gamhol senenu, they will go to our enemy's side. V'nilcham banu, and they'll fight against us. Va'ala minaretz, and throw us out of the land. We have a word for this in English. Love this word. Xenophobia.
Oh.
This is the ultimate xenophobia. Okay? They're afraid of strangers.
So if he was a monarch, he could have made a decree. The question is, why is he going to his people? Maybe.
Correct.
Maybe that Bnei Yisrael were amongst the general population. Might have been held somewhat favorably. And he was afraid to act upon them unless he got public consensus.
Why would they be, good, you're right. Why would they be looked upon favorably?
Maybe the general public still remembered what Yosef had done.
Good, exactly. The Ramban says, for Pharaoh to come out directly against Bnei Israel, people would rebel.
Okay.
Say again?
With the other.
No, that's true. But this will be a different type of rebellion. Because
right.
Now that's, you could say that's his cabinet who throws him out.
Wow.
In the first part. But desiccate him. Because the people of the land, again, I'll use America for this. The people of America do not rebel against the government, regardless of how corrupt we think it is. And boy, do we think it's corrupt. Okay, that's pretty clear. Okay, but yet, we keep voting in the same losers. It's just the most amazing thing.
We love it.
Better the devil you know than the devil you don't. That's it is. And we just keep, what's his name? Kennedy, as a person who's a resident of Massachusetts, was a resident of Massachusetts. We kept allowing, we kept putting that drunk into the place. He didn't have to run anymore. I remember passing on a train one time. I saw he had maybe 10 people around him having a rally. I'm thinking, he shouldn't be elected anymore. Somehow he was elected. I don't know how he was elected. Nobody could beat. He had to be killed. He died.
No.
But he died in office.
Yeah.
That's the only way to get rid of him. And that's crazy. Mayor Daley, I think that's the other guy, who was in jail and got elected.
FDR.
He was in jail?
No, way back. FDR.
Oh, okay. FDR, three-term president. Four term?
He died the first year of the fourth term.
We love our dynasties.
Right.
Elected four times, yeah.
Right. Yeah. But that is just so amazing when we say they're not doing the job. Everybody is pretty Moskvim today. Everybody agrees that our Congress is worthless today. Totally worthless. And so you say to them, so vote them out? No. No, I can't do that. Okay, so again, we have that thing. So we don't actively do anything. What happened? We complain. That's about it. So now when the government does something unjust, even there, how many people will go to Washington to sit in a rally?
Congress is bad. My congressman is good.
Oh. Okay, that's what you want to say. So their Congress. Okay, fine.
You know, throw them all out except for my guy.
Right, okay. Okay, however you want to put it. But like I said, here, what Pharaoh was afraid of, and by the way, he could have been afraid if I follow the first dots of Canaan. But they said, we have to deal with these people. And then he was saying no, and they threw him out, and he came back. So now he has to say, maybe I have to worry again. He could be following that same logic. That the people will do it, or my cabinet, or my people close to me, they'll try to take me out, whatever. Whatever it is, the Ramban says he could not start decrees against them without convincing them. Because what's going to happen? They're going to say, wait a second. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you invited them in. And they saved us. So how can we now turn around and say, you're worthless. It's not right. It's not just. And so he was afraid of that. So what he wanted to do was get, as you said, popular opinion. He has to get popular opinion. And he has to basically scare them enough that they are willing to do it. By the way, again, not getting too much into politics, but you've seen that in this election cycle. There's always somebody that we're afraid of. Last election, it was the Republicans are going to take down the women are going to take down women, and they're going to make them go back barefoot and pregnant.
Yeah.
That was the whole approach this time. Trump this time going again, fear-mongering against the Muslims. Well, let any Muslims. That's how it's being built. Whether or not he said it, I don't know. I didn't listen to Trump.
And the other side, fear-mongers against Trump.
Right, right. No, 100%. 100%. It's all fear-mongering, one versus the other. I'll tell you the best thing. There's a rabbi that in New York. It's not even New York. I think it's really Israel. But he's getting press from New York. Fine. He said that there weren't not 6 million Jews killed in the Holocaust. Probably only about 1 million.
No.
And his thing is that because of how the Germans declared Jewish, and if I'm one quarter Jewish on any side, I'm Jewish. So he said those people that were killed were not Jewish. No matter how many, they may have died for being Jewish. Very nice. But they weren't Jewish. Jewish is either you're born of a Jewish mother or you convert properly or you're not Jewish. So he said out of all those people, probably 1 million, maybe a little less.
Interesting.
The world, everybody's angry at him.
Uh-huh.
Fine.
Yeah.
And I read it and I was thinking, I even watched his clip. I want to see what he really did say besides what they said he said. He didn't even say that much, but okay, fine. But it's everybody on Facebook is getting angry. And so one person that I respect said something and just said this. So now assimilated Jews are not Jews? And I said, he didn't say that. Go back to the tape. It's right there. Just listen to what he said. I don't agree with what he said, but at least hear for what he said. And that's, again, fear-mongering. It's just using the rhetoric. That's what you're seeing. So what Pharaoh has to do is use the rhetoric. He has to get people afraid of this group. So what does he say? There's so many people. If somebody comes to battle against us, then these Jews are going to join with the enemy. Why would they join with the enemy? He doesn't have to explain. He just has to get that fear going. So once you're saying, oh, this is going to happen, now I have to line up against you. Now, there are a lot of theories out there, and I'll leave those all this historical theories out there to be. I'm not going to get into all the possible historical outcomes. But it seems that that's what he was doing. And like I said, Nachmanides is saying, that's why he needs people on his side. He cannot just be a monarch here and just say, we're going to take out the people. Can you imagine if anybody in America would suddenly say, not about Jews, but other people, these people are a danger to our society? How much, at that point, I think we would if they're Americans, if they're loyal Americans who have done nothing wrong. Although it happened to McCarthy. McCarthy did it with the Japanese.
It depends on who the group is.
Right. We're against war, so the whole...
Identity politics.
Right. So,
I can see it.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. This is what's going on. So I'm hoping this doesn't happen to us again. But it's... who knows? But that's what's happening here. And by the way, the biggest thing is, why do we have to review these stories over and over and over again? So this is the famous thing from the Ramban also, that Maisa Avot Simul Labanim, that whatever happened to the Avot, whatever happened to the fathers, will happen to the children. So yes, this could happen again. And yes, this is how it will happen again, if it does happen again. People will speak against us. They will make us the enemy, like Hitler, Yimach Shemo did. Yeah, and yeah. It was crazy how he did it. The Palestinians are doing it again. Again, it's all over Facebook. It doesn't take much to see all these things and to be aware of them, but they are doing it again and again and again. And they're using these fear tactics. So, yeah, it's very important to learn and to try to figure out what's going on. Like I said, the Ramban gives the reason why he's going to the people, and it's possible that's why he's doing it. And that's why you see all these fear mongers going. Okay. So then what happens? Vayasim olav sarimisim. Now they put upon them officers of, like I said, taxes. Lamana noto besiflotam, in order that they would afflict them with their hard work. Vayiven arim miskanot lefaro, and they built store cities for Pharaoh. Pitom v'et Ramses, these two cities. Now what's going on here? So it says, Lamana noto v'sivlutam shol Mitzrayim, that nor that they would be afflict them with the work of Mitzrayim. And they built these store cities. Now the problem with the store cities were that shelo hayu royot mitchila, they weren't good from the beginning. They would make them and they would fall down. It was a lousy building materials they were using, apparently. It was just a place that you couldn't do anything with. So here they have just a workforce. So I'm not sure what it was. Rosh is not identifying it, but they were trying to build it, but it wasn't Roy. It wasn't fit for it to be built. That's the problem. So they would have to work a long time. But here's the big killer. V'chashu ya'anu oto, when, just as they afflicted them, so they grew and they burst out. And they were disgusted because of the Egyptians were disgusted because of Bnei Israel. So what happens here? Rashi explains. And all that the Egyptians gave in their heart to afflict them, so also Hashem had in mind, if you will, to increase us and to make us grow tremendously. And that's why it says, the Midrash says The Ruach HaKodesh said to them, you say, lest they will increase. And I say, they shall increase. In other words, God's saying, you really want to go against me? You're really going to lose bad time, big time. Now, this is when we learned that only those who were afflicted grew in this way of having six kids, all healthy at one time. Anybody who's had, well, twins, triplets, quadruplets, everybody knows that it's not a walk in the park. You know, I said the women who had from the drugs, so she had sextuplets.
Oh,
I forget what it was, but a lot of them never died. It wasn't, and that would be the normal thing. You normally would lose some of those. Baruch Hashem with twins, I think that's pretty safe. But when it comes to triplets, and certainly more, it gets into the danger zone. And here, every single time they had kids, they would have six at a time, all healthy, all strong. Imagine that. Can you imagine birthday days on a sitting around the table? You have five pregnancies, 30 kids. The poor the moil was going crazy. But it's just amazing. But that's how you build up the group quickly. So now you have 70, and you have style of with 70. Now you're having six kids at a time, every single time. So just figure it out. I mean, I would have, if that was me, I would have had, just from the three kids I have, I would have had 18 children. It's an amazing amount of children. And, you know, talk about TV time. All the, can you imagine the iPods you have to buy for everybody?
That was before car seats.
Car seats. No, car seats, not none of these things that we have to worry about. But I think, really, I mean, if you think about it, with all the, your family, Kanahar would have, again, to the mathematics, 24. You never retire. Forget it. The retirement is gone. No fooling around. You have to work. But that's what it is. But that's all because they tried. When it came to Levi, that was because they weren't being subjugated like this. So they only got normal birth. That's why when it comes to Moshe, it was three kids. You had Moshe, Aaron, and Miriam. That's all there was. Three kids, normal growth. Wasn't anything strange. And that's why there's so little. When you look at the numbers, they had 20,000 or something. It was nothing. Compared to everybody else, it's 60,000, 70,000. It's crazy. Okay, so now what happens? We have Vidu Mitzrayim Ben Israel Beparech. Oh, I'm sorry. It says Vayakutsu. So what happened? Katsu Bechayim. They became disgusted in their own lives. And Rash and the rabbis say Kotsim Hebenehem. They became like thorns in the Egyptians' eyes. Now, why? Why would that happen? So it says, I saw somebody comment about this. I just have to remember where it was. Could have been a Midrash. But it says because they were all around. Remember before it says, it says, Vatimaleha Arts Otam. The land was filled with them. Right? So that's what it said originally. What does it mean it was filled with them? They were everywhere. Yeah. They were in the movies. They were all over, whatever you would call it. They were everywhere. So people were saying, oh my God, it's not just 70 people that are living in Goshen anymore. And wherever we go, we're tripping over Jews. Or Bnei Yisrael, whatever. We're tripping over them. So now, that's what they're... Vayakutsim Ipnei. So they were disgusted. The Egyptians were disgusted in their own lives. These Jews were like thorns in their eyes. Everywhere where they were. And remember, they're wicked. They're going to take over. Yeah. What's the proof? They're everywhere. What?
Their plan kind of failed. It backfired.
Oh.
Make them slaves so that they won't make sides our enemies. So many of them. Now there are more of them.
Right.
They hate us.
But the craziness is that they didn't realize that.
The Jews?
No, the Egyptians, well, the Jews also. But the Jews just thought it was normal. Remember one thing, if I'm having six kids at a time, I just think that's normal.
And everybody else is.
Right. Everybody says, we just think it's normal. This is how we do it. God bless us. So what? And we're living in Goshen and you're now taxing us. Okay, you know, it's normal. Because, and why is it normal? Because there's always an immigrant tax or whatever you want to call that. When I went to Canada, I wasn't a resident. I was a visitor, a visitor status. So I couldn't do everything. Fine. You understand? That's what it is. They only said they won't want to sojourn here. We don't want to live here. If Yaakov would have lived by his word, he would have left after the famine was over. Have a good day. We'll go back to Eretz Yisrael and we'll sit there and we'll take Yosef with us or we'll tell him to come visit, whatever. But because they decided to stay and they took hold of the land because they liked what it was giving them, and it was part of God's plan, we had to do it anyway. So, fine. So now that, but they thought they were getting along well with their friends in Egypt. And lo and behold, they're not. If you want a fast repeat of that, you just have to go to Germany. My father, who was grew up in Gleiwitz, so he told me that they were a middle-class family. They had a maid or whatever it was. And so what happened in once the laws, he left in 38, so the laws came into being and those, you know, I guess Nuremberg or whatever it was, and he said overnight, he was 10 years old when he left. So who knows, you know, you're listening to a 10-year-old and many, many years later. But he said overnight, my friends no longer were my friends. They wouldn't talk to me. They would spit at me when they would see me. Everything changed in one day, he said. Now that's what's going on here. You have people who are growing up. They're Egyptians. Let's understand that. They are Egyptians for all intents and purposes. They've lived there for more than 60 years. They're older than you. They're younger than you. They're older than you. You haven't lived in America for 15? 16 years. Unless you were born somewhere else, you're always in America. So you're 16 years old. As far as you know, this is your country. Yeah, Eretz Israel is a Jewish homeland, blah, blah, blah. Okay, I don't see anybody moving so quick. Let's understand that. As far as you're concerned, your home. Wherever the home is, wherever dad is, wherever mom is, that's home. Okay? But that's in America. We're not running to Israel. We don't, and as a matter of fact, when we go to Israel, we say, nice place to visit. I'm going back home. It's the language we use. And by the way, that gets into a whole bunch of halachic concepts. And you get into the whole argument of Rav Moshe versus Avadi Yosef. When I'm in Israel, I as an American, when I go to Israel, do I have 2 days or 1 day of Yom Tov?
Oh.
That's where the whole argument comes from. Where do I consider home? Where do I, what do I do? Okay, and depending on that, we'll determine what I keep. Do I keep 1 day, 2 days, what goes on? So they consider themselves Egyptians. They're totally, like my father was a German. Totally German for three generations. How many generations? Three, at least, but he grew up German. He didn't understand, why don't you like me? I'm the same guy I was yesterday. And that's what they were dealing with, okay? So they're working them hard. And they embittered their lives. With this hard work. With this bricks, the dirt, the mud and the bricks. And all the work in the field. All these works that they would serve them in hard toil. And Rashi says, Beperach is again, a play on words. Hard work that will break the body. Okay? The other play on words here is perach, right? With a soft mouth. They didn't, how they afflict them? By being nice to them. By saying, you can help, right? And once they start to help, now you're going to do this for the rest of the time. The Midrash says, that Pharaoh announced, the newspaper headlines went out, we're going to build Pitun and Ramses, and Pharaoh's there, and he's going to be the first shovel. He's going to break the ground, as it were, and he's looking for some volunteers. Of course, B'nai Israel were only too happy. They owed the king anyway. That's why we're Meshubat to Egypt. We owe him. We had a debt of gratitude to him. So they went down, and they started to dig and do all these wonderful things. So Pharaoh said, well, since you guys are here today, guess what? No. You're going to keep doing this. You are the servants of the king. Oh, very nice. Who doesn't want to be a servant of the king? Who doesn't want to serve at the pleasure of the president? It's big honors here. Great. Once you did that, Perach, we got you. A soft mouth. And again, think about how that works. If I convince you nicely, oh, it's really late. Okay. As you're looking. So if I convince you nicely, then you'll do a lot of stuff. If you don't, so no. So that's what you have to think of. Whenever you see, read, Peparech, split that word into two. Perach, and you'll see how they convinced the Jews. We'll have to stop here.